Hello, my name is Andy Brazier. This is a short presentation giving you an introduction to the management of control room alarms. The types of control rooms I'm referring to would typically be found in oil refineries, gas plants, chemical sites, power stations and similar. Operators typically receive alarms from control systems and other systems. These may be hardwired alarms to a fixed panel, but most nowadays will be computer-based. These alarms should warn operators about something that requires their prompt attention, typically an equipment malfunction or control failure. However, we see lots of problems with alarms in many control rooms, especially with the newer computer-based systems. These problems mean that alarms become a nuisance and distraction to operators, but it can have serious safety consequences. In 1994, there was a large fire and explosion at Texaco's refinery in Milford Haven, South Wales, in the United Kingdom. It caused a lot of damage, but luckily no one was killed or seriously injured. The UK regulator, the Health and Safety Executive, or HSE, investigated the accident and uncovered a number of significant issues with alarms. In particular, they found that the operator received a large number of alarms in the run-up to the accident, with over 200 occurring in 10 minutes at one stage. The alarms that they received were poorly prioritised, so the operator could not decide which ones were important. The graphical displays provided were not effective for the operator, meaning they did not realise what was going on, and the operators had not been trained in how to deal with alarms or incidents. This accident report has informed a lot of information about alarms currently in use, though it's worth noting the accident occurred more than 20 years ago, but the same problems persist. We see many of the same problems at sites all over the world. One of them is that operators receive lots of alarms during the normal day that they don't need to respond to. These cause nuisance and distraction and are of no practical benefit to the operator. Then when things start to go wrong, the operator receives a lot of alarms in a flood. They can't work out what is going on or what has caused it. Many sites have a lot of alarms active all the time. These standing alarms occur due to poor design or management of change, or as the result of poor maintenance of instruments. Standing alarms are no use to anyone. Most systems allow alarms to be prioritised, but this feature is often used badly. A common mistake is to give every alarm a high priority, which essentially means there is no priority. And then we have the problem where operators receive alarms they don't recognise or understand, or don't know how to respond. This often occurs because operators are not actively involved in designing the alarms. Fundamentally, the main problem is there's simply too many alarms configured on a system. This is largely an unfortunate consequence of computer-based control systems allowing alarms to be added very easily and cheaply. So designers have tended to do this without thinking through what the operator needs or what the operator can handle in practice. There's a clear consensus across the affected industries that we need to improve the way alarms are managed. To do this, we need to have a clear definition of what an alarm is and a policy on how alarms should be used. We need to have some way of prioritising alarms, so that would be some sort of guide or procedure to make sure we do that in a consistent way. Alarms need to be reviewed and rationalised. This should be a standard activity for any project, including any significant modification. And also, at most sites, existing alarms should go through the same process. And when we've done that, we want to be sure that we've had a positive effect. So monitoring performance, using that data to decide, have we got a problem? Other things we're doing making the problem better? You know, that's got to be an important part of this process. A lot of problems with alarms have come about because systems have been designed without a clear definition of what an alarm is, or how they should be used. You should have your own definition, one that is appropriate for your organisation, but something along the lines of a means of directing an operator's attention to something that requires their timely assessment and action would be a good place to start. Alarms typically create an audible signal, and the operator then receives information visually to allow them to identify the alarm. An alarm can be assigned to a wide range of events and conditions, so it is important to focus on what is important. This will certainly include safety and significant environmental hazards, and probably major damage to equipment. You can try to cover more issues such as production and quality, but in practice this is very difficult to achieve whilst maintaining the other objectives with alarm management. It's also important to recognise that alarms do not operate in isolation. They are only part of an overall risk management system. In fact, there are relatively poor methods of controlling risk, appearing low on the hierarchy of risk control. So you should only consider the use of an alarm after you are satisfied that all options to implement inherent safety and engineering controls have been implemented. Also, you should be sure that the human-machine interface, or HMI, which is typically the set of graphics used by the operator to monitor the system, is as good as it can be, to allow the operator to proactively operate their plant instead of relying on alarms, which is operating reactively. In most cases, the main role of the alarm is to allow the operator to intervene when things go wrong early enough to avoid an automated protection device, such as a safety instrumented system or trip, to activate. In other words, the operator's response to the alarm is a barrier or layer of protection, but not the only one. The general idea is that more barriers there are in place, the less vulnerable you are to one failing, noting that no automated system will ever be 100% reliable. It is important to understand, though, when you're improving alarms, that everyone configured on your system and everyone received by the operator is important. They need to be designed so that they attract the operator's attention, inform them about what has happened in a way that they understand, and guides them to make the correct decision about how they should respond. The work you do needs to make sure that every alarm is useful and relevant to the operator. Other people may be interested in things that could be alarms, but unless they are sat in front of the system 24/7, these things should not be alarms. Every alarm should have a defined and documented response. This is one of the key things in making sure an alarm is justified. Every alarm has to sound at the right time so that the operator has enough time to respond in order to avoid the problem the alarm is warning you about. One thing that can help to improve your alarms is to look at what is an alarm. Now, some of these we would call alerts. An alert is an indication that something has happened that may be interesting to the operator, but they do not need to respond to. There will be no safety or environmental consequences if the operator does not respond to an alert. And these can be a very useful way of reducing the alarm count without depriving the operator of interesting or useful information. Alerts will normally not create an audible signal and will be listed separately from alarms. So they're available for the operator to see, but if he or she is dealing with an alarm, they are not being distracted by something that's of lesser importance. We call that an alert. When reviewing alarms, it becomes clear that lots of events and conditions are being alarmed that should not be. Examples of what should not create an alarm include indications of current status, and records of status changes that are considered to be normal part of operation or would be expected. Activation of a safety instrumented system or trip should not be an alarm in their own right, as they occur automatically without operator intervention, although knock-on effects may need to be considered. Duplicate signals should not create duplicate alarms, and there should not be any alarms to indicate that something the operator has done has been successful. For example, if an operator manually stops a pump, this should not create an alarm to say the pump has stopped. They will get that information from another means. Okay, so once we know what alarms we should have, we can start to think about their priority. A very important message here is that every alarm is important, and the operator is expected to respond to every alarm immediately. A low priority does not mean the alarm is not important or that response can be delayed. The purpose of prioritisation is to assist the operator if two or more alarms occur at the same time, so they know where to focus their attention. Three or four levels of priority are usually sufficient. Low priority alarms are often called advisory. You may use a medium priority, although this is often not necessary. High is generally the highest priority for normal alarms, giving operators a warning about something requiring particular attention. The final priority is often called critical, but this is a special case and we need to discuss that separately, which we will do in a minute. You will need to generate your own rules or guidelines for determining alarm priorities. It needs to fit your organisation. But I'm going to show you a flow chart here that you might want to use as a basis. So you're going to start with something that you think could or should be an alarm. The first question to ask is, how serious is the consequence that could occur if the alarm is not responded to? You'll need to decide how you differentiate the severity, but it would normally be a safety hazard with the potential to cause a major accident would be considered significant. And the reality is most would actually have a lesser concern. So with looking at the consequence, could it result in a major safety concern, or is it sort of a lesser concern? So if we're going down the major route first of all, our next question is, what length of time does the operator have to respond to that? Again, you need to decide what counts as a short time and what is a more modest amount of time. I've proposed 20 minutes here. You may want to adjust that a little bit. So we've got less than 20 minutes is available, more than 20 minutes is available. And so we come to our first priority at this point. So we've said the potential consequences are major, the time available is less than 20 minutes, high priority will be a reasonable response, a reasonable priority in that case. But that leaves the alternative. So the alternative is then we end up asking the same question again. So we've decided that either the consequence is less than major or the time available is greater than 20 minutes. This then says, well, what is the time available? If it's less than 4 hours, and I've used that as an indication of a modest amount of time is available. If the time's less than 4 hours, we've probably got a low priority alarm on our hands. If we get to this point and we decide, well, actually, the operator is going to have more than 4 hours to respond, the normal conclusion would be that an alarm is not required. It couldn't be justified because the operator doesn't need to respond promptly, which was how we define what an alarm is. That being the case, you may delete that alarm, or you may feel that making it an alert instead will be an appropriate solution to that. I mentioned previously about critical alarms being a special case, and the reality is you may not have any. Critical alarms are used where an operator action is required to avoid an immediate or significant hazard. This is usually because there is no automatic protection in place, either because it's technically not possible or there's some other reason why you wouldn't want to do that. However, if you go through your review and you do decide that one or more of your alarms falls into the critical category, the first thing you should always do is look for a better solution. Can you engineer out that problem so that we're not relying on these critical alarms? That must always be considered first. If you find, going through due process, that you must keep this critical alarm, you need to have very robust systems in place. This means the means of notifying the operator of the alarm must be very reliable. Critical alarms must be clearly differentiated from all normal alarms, so that might be your high and low priority alarms. The operator response must be fully documented, typically as a specific procedure on how to deal with that situation. And operators must be assessed as competent in that response. So for every critical alarm you identify, you are creating quite a lot of extra work. That's why it is better to engineer them out if you possibly can. And just as a quick rule of thumb, our aim with this prioritisation would be to have around 20% to be higher priority and 80% to lower priority, with our aim to be for there to be no critical alarms or very few if we decide that some are required. I just want to take a couple of words about logical processing of alarms, as this is a specialist field and it's really something that is outside the scope of this short presentation. The important thing is you want to make sure you go through the basics first before you start to think about any additional measures. But the value of them is we've already said that every alarm received by the operator should be useful, and this may depend on the mode of operation. Making alarms conditional on some other condition may be useful. For example, a low flow alarm is not useful if the operator has decided to stop a pump. So some form of logical programming can be used to only activate that alarm when the pump is running. So pump's running and a low flow is occurring, we know we've got a problem. Pump's not running, low flow is not an indication of a problem. That's simple conditional alarming. There are more sophisticated options available. These need to be used in great care, and I don't wish to discuss that any further in this short presentation. Okay, so I've tried to introduce you to the basic principles of what we're trying to do with alarm management. So now we need to put the ideas presented so far into practice. This may be something you'll do to existing alarms, do a review of what you've already got in place, or as part of a project that is introducing new alarms. You will need your clear definition of what an alarm is, as well as a policy and guide or rules for prioritisation. You then need to work through every alarm, and I'm afraid there are no shortcuts to this. So you take an alarm, the first thing you want to do is review the alarm and decide, yes, should it be an alarm? Does it satisfy the definition and the policy that you've set? Then look at how it's being described. Is it using language? Is it described in a way that the operators will understand? The next thing you ask yourself is, how will the operator respond to that? And this is something you need to discuss and write down. That's something you want to keep for forever. When you get to this stage, consider the priority. Again, using the rules, the guidelines that you've set yourself. Also be asking yourself, do we need to put some sort of logical processing, make this alarm conditional? Probably on your first run through an alarm review, that's not something you want to be considering. Maybe in future reviews in future years, that's maybe something you want to do. But you also need to be looking at the alarm set points. Are they appropriate? Do they give the operator enough time to realistically respond to this situation? And we need to capture the findings of this review. I'm going to use a very simple hypothetical example to illustrate the alarm review process. What we have here is a vessel with a flow of liquid in and flow out. It normally operates at 30% full, so the level would be around the 30% mark. If the level in the vessel reaches 100%, the liquid will flow out, causing a safety hazard. It will overflow. To avoid this, we have a trip set at 90% level. This would shut the inlet valve. If that happens, the level should stop going up. An alarm would also activate at that point. We also have what might be called a pre-trip alarm set at the 70% level. The idea being that will occur before we get to the trip point. It gives the operator some time to intervene. What we're going to do here is review the two level alarms. This table here is how we're going to, it's going to lead us through that review, and it allows us to document our findings. It asks us to identify the alarm. We then consider, what are we fundamentally trying to do? Not just what is the alarm there to do, but what is the whole aim of the system we've got in place. We then say if that alarm occurs, what would we expect the operator response to be? And we would say if they don't respond in time, what could the consequence be? We'll ask ourselves, how much time do they have to respond to avoid that consequence? And based on that, we can record a priority. So we first look at that what we'd call the high-level alarm, that was the one set at the 70% level on the vessel. What we're trying to do overall, we're trying to avoid overfilling the vessel that would cause a spill and have safety consequences. So if the operator receives the alarm at 70% level, they have a response. They should reduce the inlet flow to that vessel, and they may consider shutting the inlet valve completely. If they don't do that quickly enough and the level reaches the 90% mark, the trip will activate. That will shut the inlet valve for them, that will stop the level going up. That's an automatic response that will happen if the operator doesn't respond in time. The time available to react will depend on how quickly the level in the vessel can rise. In this case, if the vessel level can rise 1% per minute, it will take 20 minutes to go from the 70% point where the alarm would activate to the point where the trip would activate, which is at 90%. So based on that, a 20 minute time scale, that would typically be a high priority alarm. It's a relatively short amount of time. This is assuming that the consequence, the overflow, is of a significant safety concern. So based on that, our high-level alarm set at the 70% mark is a high-priority alarm. But if you remember, we then had another alarm set. We had a what might be called the high-high level. That would be set at the 90% mark, which is at the same point as the automatic trip occurs. We're still trying to avoid the same thing. There's also the same parameters. The thing is here, the trip happens automatically. The operator doesn't intervene. So actually, there's no operator action. If the operator doesn't respond, there's no consequence. And so the time available becomes irrelevant. It's not applicable. And so, in fact, there's no justification for having an alarm in this case. What we might do, we might consider changing it to an alert, or we might just delete that alarm completely. This is counterintuitive to a lot of people who feel, well, when we're at the 90% level on that vessel, the operator needs to be very aware of what's going on. But the key point is, no, actually, there's nothing for the operator to do. They should have responded at the 70% mark, which is where the high level alarm was set. If they fail to respond for whatever reason, the trip will automatically happen and make the system safe. Just to keep to the same example, we'll go back to the high level alarm again, the one set at the 70% mark. But just consider an alternative scenario where instead of the level rising 1% per minute, we'd say it rises at half that rate, so 1% every 2 minutes. In that case, the time available to respond increases from 20 minutes to 40 minutes. And we may well then say, depending on the rules you've set, it's more likely to be a low priority alarm there. So that was just to illustrate that, if the time available, it's the time available that typically decides. Now, the final thing you need to think about is what does look good like in terms of alarm performance. This is something you'd be looking at to decide if you have a problem in the first place, and to confirm the work you do to improve does actually create an improvement. This table gives you an idea of the types of performance indicators you may want to use, but again, you should probably generate your own. So something like an average alarm rate of 6 alarms per hour, which equates to 1 per every 10 minutes, that's a good indication of how much demand the system is putting on the operator during normal operations. Really, are we getting a lot of nuisance alarms? 6 per hour is seen as as a rule of thumb, as a good benchmark. We've then got to consider when things start to go wrong, and we do accept that there will probably be additional alarms. But if we allow that too many alarms to occur for too long, the operator will become overloaded. So the benchmark is typically set for 10 alarms in the first 10 minutes of an upset or a problem. And after that, we should really be going back to our average alarm rate. Ideally, there would be no standing alarms, suppressed or shelved alarms, as these indicate that either the alarm's not designed for the mode of operation, or that there's problems with instrumentation, reliability, or maintenance. So, let's say that's something you may want to look at now if you've got an existing system to say, have you got a problem? And certainly something you'd want to be keeping an eye on if you are starting to make changes to your system. Now, quick introduction. To give you an idea of the types of things you might need to think about. If you want to do something about this, you will need some probably more guidance. Now, there is a free, simple guide that anybody can download from the UK's Health and Safety Executive. I've given you the website there. And there is a number of paid-for publications that are used widely across the world. You've got EMUR 191, which is from the Engineering Equipment and Materials Users Association. That's certainly very widely used in the UK and typically held up as an approved code of practice. You've got IEC 82682 from the International Electrotechnical Commission, and ISA 18.2 from the International Society of Automation. Those are places you may want to go for further guidance. So I hope you found this useful, and thank you for your interest. If you do have any questions, please don't hesitate to contact me. My details are there, and I would very much welcome your questions, comments, suggestions, and ideas. And good luck with your alarm management. Thank you.